Hello and good morning, everyone. My name is Lindsay Lunau and I'm the coordinator of environmental education, climate and environment business unit. I'd like to welcome you to our final day of the Mayor's Environment Expo. Just to get us started, I'm hoping that you can locate the Q&A. It looks like two overlapping speech bubbles with the top one having a question mark in the middle. We'd love if you could tell us where you're joining us from. So feel free to put in the city if you'd like, or the school, or which class you're in, and the grade or grades that are joining us today. We'd also just like to get started by thanking sponsors. We put on the expo without the good folks joining us and helping to get the expo and supporting our workshops. And before I hand it over to Ben for his presentation, we'd just like to hand it over to Mayor Gondek for a few words.
Welcome to the 33rd annual Mayor's Environment Expo. As we come together from around the city, I would like to acknowledge that the Calgary area where the Bow and Elbow Rivers meet is a place of confluence where the sharing of ideas and opportunities naturally come together. Indigenous people were the original caretakers of this land and the first champions of environmental conservation. This land is a home that we all share, and it's vitally important that we protect our home, our environment, by working together. What drives my optimism is seeing the innovation and commitment to climate action from all of you, our students. I will continue to amplify youth voices on the climate crisis, and I look forward to hearing your ideas. I hope this session sparks conversations and encourages all of us to take greater action in protecting our environment. Thank you all for participating.
Hey everyone, welcome to Climate, Water, and Us. Great sunny Friday morning. I'm Ben Ethier. I'm the Senior Water Adaptation and Mitigation Specialist at the City of Calgary. That's just a really long name to say that I'm a water climate change specialist here at the city. Just wanted to give everyone a heads up as well. Today's session is being recorded, and to protect the privacy of everybody, we're not going to share audio or video from anyone else. You'll just be able to see me, Lindsay, and anybody else who's answering questions. But like Lindsay said, definitely interact with me and with anyone else through the Q&A section at the top there. And we're also going to, well, there'll be room for questions at the very end. So feel free to kind of type them in as you go, and we'll answer them at the very end of the presentation. So the agenda, I always like to let people know what to expect. Can't drive a bus looking out the back window. We always say that in climate change. So here's what to expect moving forward. Give you kind of a quick rundown on what is the watershed and kind of where we are in the watershed, that kind of thing. We'll go over some kind of basics about climate versus weather and how climate is impacting us at water or the water we use. Then we'll talk about how climate impacts you, what it is the City of Calgary is doing, and then finally we'll end on some things that you can do, both at your home, at your school, and in and around the community. So what is a watershed? Well, the very basic definition of a watershed is an area of land that drains to the same location. This all has to do with the topography of an area. That's the hills, the slopes, the valleys. You can kind of think of it like a big natural funnel. Generally, the higher points like the mountains and ridges form boundaries around the watershed. Water flows down these boundaries and down the valleys into the lower elevation areas like rivers, lakes, wetlands, and streams. So where does all the water in our rivers come from? It should be no big surprise to hear that the majority of our water in Calgary comes from the snowmelt near the mountains, draining into our rivers upstream. So which watershed are we in? You can kind of see the little yellow, not little, I guess, the yellow shaded area in the middle, and that's Calgary. Everything to the left or to the west, that's all of our watershed. That's everything that drains into Calgary. Everything to the right or to the east is everything that Calgary drains towards. So yeah, to answer, it's a bit complex about where we are in the watershed, but generally, Calgary's part of the Bow River watershed. One thing to note is the size of the watershed in comparison to Calgary. You can see on the side there, there's a photo of the entire watershed, upstream and downstream, like I said. Like I mentioned, the yellow highlight in the middle is Calgary. The total watershed covers about 26,000 square kilometers. Flows start up in the mountains, making their way down through Calgary, passing through Calgary, and then it meets at the South Saskatchewan River. Actually, eventually, this water ends up flowing all the way to the Hudson's Bay. Larger watersheds can be broken down into smaller watersheds, depending on the drainage basin. For example, this map here, this map shows some of the smaller drainage areas within the city of Calgary, within the city limits. There's some smaller areas of land that drain into creeks and streams, but we really designate those as sub-watersheds, and they do all eventually flow into the Bow River. It becomes part of the larger watershed. So I really hope this helps you to kind of connect with the river that we live on. Mayor Gondak did a great piece mentioning that we're kind of at the confluence of the Bow and the Elbow. And we've put together a little video that kind of helps connect people to the river that we live on. So that's what we'll do next. It's a short little 5-minute video I'll play for you, and we'll go from there. This is called I Am the River.
I am the river. I am the river, and this is my story. Long ago, I ran pure and free. Many consider me sacred. Where two branches of my waters meet, some call me Moginstus. At the confluence of these two rivers, the lifeblood of our city, cultures converged as new communities were built. People needed me. They depended on me for drinking water, for agriculture, for electricity. I tried my best, and people realized how important I was. They cared and wanted to protect me. The water that came back to me was cleaner, but people started to compete over me. Communities grew and demanded more. And then there was a storm, and I flowed wildly, and people got scared. They understood my strength. Now, I worry how a changing climate will affect me. Drought, floods, and forest fires will become more common. And even if communities grow with care, will I have enough water to give when there are 3 million that depend on me? I want people to know my story, so they care, so they act. Work together to protect the land around me, keep my waters clean to drink, and protect the fish and plants, so people can continue to enjoy hiking my shores and paddling my waves. Use my resources wisely, give me room to move, keep me resilient. I am your river, and this is our story.
So I hope that was helpful for everyone to kind of connect place, connect where we are, and connect with the river that we rely on here in the city of Calgary. So the next piece we're going to talk about is climate versus weather. The biggest difference between climate and wind weather comes down to the time frame. Weather is really short term. Climate is long term. Normally with climate, we're talking about a state of the atmosphere for a few hours, a few days, maybe a few weeks, rarely a few months. With climate, we're looking at regular trends in the behavior of the atmosphere. Experts normally measure this using a 30-year average. And we predict climate change out to the 2050s and 2080s. Normally, when we talk about weather or the state of the atmosphere, we're looking at these different measurements. We're looking at temperature, humidity, precipitation, cloudiness, brightness, visibility, wind, atmospheric pressure. These are all the kind of things you see from the weatherman, you know, in the morning when you turn on the TV. a few easy ways to, or an easy, a really easy way that I like to help remember the difference is that climate's what you expect in the future. Weather is what you get today and tomorrow. So next we're going to go through a few quick examples here. See if we can determine kind of the difference. I'll give everybody a few minutes, probably maybe 1 or 2 minutes in the classroom. And if we could just poll the classroom and then type into the chat kind of what our thoughts are, whether it's weather or whether it's climate change, weather or climate change. So here's the first one. It rained all last weekend, and it's going to rain next week. Do we think that's weather or do we think that's climate change? So I'll pause here for a couple minutes, about 2 minutes, and I'll let everybody kind of put into the chat there what we think, weather or climate change.
So Ben, we do know that there's a little bit of a delay in the time that we say something to when students hear us. So we'll wait for some answers to come in. Could you just repeat the question one more time?
Yep, so just here we have, is it weather or is it climate change? It rained all weekend last weekend, and it's going to rain next week. Is that weather or is that climate change?
Awesome. I do see some answers coming in. So we have a good mix. Most people are saying weather, but we do have a couple that have said climate here.
Perfect. So this is actually an example of weather. Just because it rained last weekend doesn't mean it's actually going to rain next weekend. And it doesn't tell us really what we're going to expect this time next year. So that's actually an example of weather. So the next one, I'll do the same here. Is it weather or is it climate? My parents are always telling me that the winters are now not the same as they were when they were my age. Again, is that weather or is it climate? So I'll take a little pause. Lindsay, I'll let you give me a ring when we have a few answers, okay?
You bet. And I actually hear that from my parents all the time. They're telling me that the winters are not the same as when they were a kid.
And they had to walk uphill both ways to get to school, right?
That is correct. Yeah. With snow over their heads.
Exactly.
All right. So we do have a few answers starting to come in. Maybe I'll just wait for a couple more before I publish what we've got. Okay, awesome. So I've got climate. It seems unanimous. It is climate, is what people have said so far.
We've got it. This is an example of climate. So the trends in the amount of snowfall we get year to year have definitely changed over the past few decades. And this is starting to show us how our climate has been changing long term. So I've got another one for us here. Last summer, there was a heat wave for several weeks. Is that climate or is that weather? And this one's actually true. I do remember the heat wave last summer and it was hot.
Okay, Ben, there are a few answers coming in here. We don't seem to have a good consensus, though. So I've got a couple of weather that have come in and a couple climate as well.
This one's a bit tricky. It's actually an example of weather. So while we do have some hot summers as part of our climate, it's not a regular trend. We do sometimes get heat waves of 40 degrees kind of in July, August. And the fact that we had a heat wave last summer doesn't really mean that we're going to have a heat wave next summer or this summer. However, this is the tricky part. This is kind of where we could go either way. If this does become a regular trend and we're seeing our summers becoming warmer, that is an indication of a new climate trend or a change in our climate. So I would give it to both. I mean, it could go either way. I think this is an example of climate change or an example of weather, but as we start to see more and more of these heat waves, we start to see our summers getting hotter and hotter. That is an example of climate change. I might have been a bit tricky in my wording. So here's the last one. Oh, sorry.
Our audience was right on the last one when there was not consensus amongst everyone.
Yeah, exactly. That's fair. So here's another bit of a tricky one. Here's the last one too. I'll leave it on the last one here. There've been many wildfires across Western Canada over the past few years. Is that weather or is it climate change?
I can remember in the last couple of years, we have had a couple of pretty smoky days where our air quality health index was quite high, like a 9 or a 10.
Yeah, I remember I play soccer, and I remember, I think it was last summer, they had to cancel our soccer league because it was just so smoky. They didn't want us out running around and breathing heavily. So yeah, it's been a few years in a row now that it's been smoky.
Yeah, that's a real impact that we're feeling of climate change already. So we do have a few answers starting to come in. So I've got climate change, climate, weather, climate, and the event caused by climate change.
Awesome. So again, this was another tricky one. It's a bit of both. So the wildfires year to year are kind of caused by those annual weather conditions. So drier years will have more wildfires. So the wildfires themselves are caused by kind of local weather conditions. But here's the tricky part, as they increase in frequency, so as we see more and more wildfires, that's an indication of a climate trend. So hotter, drier summers mean we're going to see more and more wildfires. So just another thing to note that while wildfires aren't really a measure of weather or climate change, they definitely often come as a result of what we're seeing. So I hope that was helpful to kind of, I threw a few curveballs in there because it can be tricky, especially when you start to drill down into it. But I hope that was helpful to kind of, you know, work through the difference between climate and weather. So the next piece here are the hazards we're going to see for water. So what might we see more of in Calgary due to the changing climate? I put up a list here. This comes from our climate resilience strategy that actually was a committee and is going to go to council next Tuesday. So if you're interested in kind of keeping an eye on what Mayor Gondak and the rest of council are doing with climate change, definitely tune in Tuesday morning. Tuesday at 9 o'clock, they'll be in Council Falls. So here's the list of hazards generally that we're seeing. Extreme heat, obviously, wildfires, we just talked about that. Drought, as we see less rainfall and hotter, drier summers, we're going to see more droughts. Flood events, actually, the more rain we see and the more we see, the more floods we're going to start to see, and the deeper and bigger the floods we'll see. Damaging storms, like hailstorms. Interestingly, more winter storms. Another one that really starts to impact us in water and how we see water is actually shifting seasons. And what we like to say here is that we really are seeing water. We're seeing more water when we don't need it in the springs, and less in the spring, and less water in the summers when we actually do need it. So now you'll start to see that there's more water flowing in the rivers. That's when we don't need it. We don't need it because there's a chance of floods and that kind of thing. But what happens is the water ends up trickling off, and we don't get as much water when we need it when it's drier in July and August. So you can probably see here, most of them have a little green check mark. The only one that didn't really pose a hazard to water was tornadoes. So just again, does anyone kind of remember the big hailstorms we had over the last few years? Just trying to think back to some of how these some of hazards have kind of impacted us in the city. Do people remember the smoky air we talked about just in the previous slide there? Was anyone around for the 2013 floods, or maybe even the 2005 floods? We talked about this one as well. How about the heat wave last summer? I remember it was hot, and I don't have air conditioning at home, so I was hot. I will never forget that. We haven't seen a really serious drought in a little while, but talking to our drought team, it's already starting to look drier than normal this year, so we're starting to see that poke its head up. And since we can't control the weather or the climate, we have to start to adapt to these changes. Thinking back to some of these events you might have already experienced, think, were there any ways that you were able to deal with the extreme weather, making it easier to handle? During the heat wave last summer, did you spend more time outside or did you spend more time inside in the air conditioning? Were you in the sun or did you try and stay in the shade? Did you go swimming maybe to stay cool in our rivers or some of the outdoor pools? And then what about drought? Do you have rain barrels to capture the water? Do you have a big green lawn in the front of your house that you have to water every day just to keep it green? And there's some things like floods and heavy rains that are a lot harder to prepare for. But us at the City of Calgary, we're trying to take action to reduce those risks for you as well that are harder to reduce at home. Is there anything else we can do to build resiliency? If we're going to have heat waves and drought conditions, there's going to be a higher demand for water. And if we can adjust our behavior now, it'll be easier to manage the extreme weather. Small actions like taking shorter showers or only running the washing machine with full loads, those can make a big difference. Like I said, something like a rain barrel outside can help a lot too. Like I said, with the changing seasons, how we're getting more water when we don't need it and we're not getting water when we do need it. Rain barrels help. They help us store water when it rains a lot, and we can save it and use it to water the garden when it's hotter and drier. So what are some of the things the city is doing? I mentioned we're doing some stuff as well to make sure that, you know, we're staying ahead of things. I mentioned the Calgary Climate Strategy and action plans. Take a look if you're interested. If this is something that interests you, it's going to council on Tuesday at 9 a.m. You can tune in and watch the live stream. Take a look, see what's going on, see some of the things that we're doing. And as part of that, the water utility, we provide water, wastewater, stormwater services to everyone in Calgary. And we've started to put together our own climate change strategy as well to help get ahead of these things that we're starting to see now. So what I did is I put together a few plans that I know here at Water that we've actually made it a concerted effort to include climate change in. Calgary's flood resilience plan, there's a section specifically dedicated to climate change. Our source water protection plan, making sure that the water that we get in Calgary is clean and that we can treat it so that everybody has drinking water. We've also made sure that climate change is included in that, making sure we're protecting water out for future generations. And the water efficiency plan update, definitely, again, I talked about a bunch of water efficiency pieces you can do at home, and that has a big climate change piece to play as well. What are some other things we're doing? We're also taking action to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions that we have at the city and that we have for water. One of the interesting pieces that I've gotten to see here in my career is the green fleet. Water has a fleet of electric vehicles that we have plugged in. I've got a photo right there in the top corner. That's actually one of our electric fleet cars. We have a few of them now, and they're fantastic. It's great to see. Another one is solar generation. So both of our water treatment plants have big solar generation fields. A few of our building remodels have included solar panels on the roof. And a few of our wastewater treatment plants are starting to add solar panels as well. So we're looking at that. And then another interesting piece is what's called cogeneration. This one's a bit more complex, but I'll try and do my best to explain it. What happens when we treat wastewater that comes in from the sewers is in part of that process, we create methane gas. And what we used to do is we would just burn the methane gas off, let it go into the atmosphere, and that was it. What we do now is we capture that methane gas. We use it to boil water, create steam, and create electricity and heat for the rest of our processes. So we're taking that gas that we would have otherwise just burned off and using it to create green electricity, essentially. So that's another interesting piece that's underway here at Water. And if you want more information on that, you can definitely let us know. There's some great online resources that help especially for educators and teachers and classrooms, to help kind of do a virtual tour of our water treatment and our wastewater treatment processes and plants, to kind of help you get a better understanding of what happens to that water after you flush it down the toilet or down the drain, and even how we get it to your faucet in the first place. So definitely, if there's some interest, we can add some links to that as well. So that was the mitigation side, reducing our greenhouse gas emissions, reducing our footprints. And I'd mentioned there were things that the city was doing to kind of help protect large portions of the city that are at risk to those hazards. The first one's flood barriers. If anyone's been down to Eau Claire, you've probably seen all the construction that's going down in the Eau Claire Plaza right now. That's part of our flood barriers. What we're doing there is we're connecting the flood barriers further up along the river, and we're continuing them on further down to continue to protect the downtown area from floods like we saw in 2013. If you've been down the river walk, you might have seen those benches, you might have seen the gaps in the benches. I just wanted to share this because I think it's really interesting. This is how the flood barrier works. We have these slats that sit in those gaps. We send crews out if there's a flood and we deploy those, and it connects the barrier without disconnecting the rest of the city from the river. So that was an important design function that we really tried to make sure that we keep people connected with the river. The next one is rain gardens or green stormwater infrastructure. You've probably seen when it rains really hard, you get pooling of water kind of on the streets. As much as that's normal, if we get too much, it can overwhelm our storm system and it can flood basements and houses. And what we've started to do is we've started to install rain gardens. They're essentially water-loving plants in low areas. So when it rains, instead of the water pooling on the roads, it goes to this area where there's grass, there's trees, there's shrubs, and it actually, the trees and shrubs help absorb the water. And it slows down the water kind of going into the storm system. Another one that I think is really interesting was the Glenmore Dam upgrades. You might have seen the redevelopment and the new pieces of pathway on top of the dam. What you might not have seen is kind of the important infrastructure that went in underneath the dam. And we installed some brand new gates that help raise the level of the reservoir so that we can store more water now when we're getting it, so that we can use it later in the summers. And it also helps kind of protect from those fluctuations. So I've got another quick video that kind of helps better explain kind of what those Glenmore Dam upgrades look like and what they're doing. So I hope that helps better explain those ones, because I think that one's a really, really interesting engineering piece.
Upgrades at the Glenmore Dam, including the addition of new gates, will help ensure we keep up with the water needs in our growing city and reduce future flooding. By installing 2.5 meter high steel gates, we've doubled the amount of water we can store in the reservoir, so we can manage higher river flows in the spring and have a more reliable water supply throughout the year. This investment is an important step forward in building Calgary's flood resiliency. And when the province completes the Springbank Reservoir, communities along the Elbow River will be protected from overland flooding during a 2013 sized event. For more information on how we're making Calgary more flood ready and how you can be ready too, visit calgary.ca/floodinfo.
So that's what we're doing at the city. I wanted to give you all a little bit of a few things you can take home, things that you can do, or you and your family can do at home, or you can do at school even. A really quick and easy one is to check for leaks. Go to calgary.ca/waterguide. There's some great things you can do with your parents, or if you're an older student, maybe grade 12, there's some things and you're somewhat handy, there's some things you can do as well to help kind of check for leaks. The less leaking water we have, the less water we're having to treat, the less emissions we're having treating that water, and the more water we have for when it's a bit drier and we need that water. Another one to help kind of reduce the impact on the water we use is aerators on taps. What that does is it adds a little bit of air into the faucet so that when you're washing your hands, you're not using nearly as much water. Another thing is to install rain barrels or point downspouts towards your gardens where the water's needed. Another piece, we just released our yard smart guide with perennials and actually some native plants. So if you're a bit into gardening and now is the time, right after May long, it's a nice sunny day headed into the weekend, plant more perennials in the gardens and around the house or around the school. These are plants that are extra hardy and extra tough because they come back year after year, and they don't need a lot of water to continue to be beautiful. Even better than that, like I mentioned, we just released our native plant guide. So even better than the perennials are native plants. They help too because they support bees, butterflies, and they're tuned to this climate, this environment. So they're really set up to do well when it's drier or when it's wetter in the spring. So take a look at those. You can find those at calgary.ca/yardsmart. We're getting to the end here. Lindsay's going to drop a couple of these resources into the bar so that everybody has them. You can check them out, calgary.ca/water. That's just the water page in general. You can kind of see what we're doing here at the water utility. calgary.ca/climateaction. Take a peek at that. That's a very interesting site. Lindsay's group is really starting to move the bar on climate action. And like I said, take a peek. If you're interested in climate action, take a peek on their presentation to council on Tuesday. The other one to take a look at is calgary.ca/water guide. So that's going to help you with water efficiency, leak detection for toilets and sinks, ways to use less water around your house. And the last one is calgary.ca/yardsmart. Definitely check that out if you're into gardening. I love it. I planted my whole backyard garden using tips and tricks from YardSmart. They have a design tool to help you kind of pick what you want to go where. They also have a tool that helps you decide which plants would be best in sunny locations, not such sunny locations, that kind of thing. So yeah, definitely take a peek if you or your family is interested in gardening. And then finally, I think Lindsay's going to send out some links. We've got a couple other kind of handout type resources that she'll be emailing out. What we've got is we've got a little graphic to kind of help you see around the house some other little checkbox things that you can do in and around the house or the school maybe. And we'll also send out a checklist that you can bring home to work through with your parents to make sure that your home, your house, and your school are ready for climate change, or ready for the things we're going to start to see from climate change. So with that, I'll leave it at any questions. Lindsay?
Yeah, so I do have a couple of questions that are starting to come in here. So sorry, just let me publish them, Ben, and then I'll be able to ask them. Just one second. So the first one, I think you did mention it already, but the question was, where can I find information about good plants to use?
Awesome. Great question. I love it. Thank you very much. I might have harped on it a lot, but definitely go to calgary.ca/yardsmart. They have a ton of great resources, so I would check that out.
Awesome. And the next question that's come in is, what is the biggest use of water in Calgary?
Ooh, that's a good question. It's definitely, I don't know specifically. I'd have to ask some of my colleagues that are more in tune with kind of the water use, but I do know a lot of water goes to uses that we return to the river. So washing, cooking, cleaning, and then in the summer we do see a peak in watering of gardens and lawns, especially when it's hot and dry. Last summer when we saw that heat wave, we actually ended up having to treat, I think, the most water we've ever treated in 15 years, just because there was such a demand for people needing water. So not exactly the answer you're looking for, but I hope it kind of helped out.
And I think it's really interesting, like there must be some sort of breakdown between the commercial use of water or the use of water like in hospitals or other institutions compared to residential use. That watering of lawns is definitely a huge use of the residential water. So rain barrels are an awesome way to go. So we do have another question that's come specifically for you, Ben. What is your favorite water-wise perennial?
That's a good question. I have to stand up and look over here. I'm a big fan of lupins. They're purple. Oh, it's hard to explain. They're purple, tall, narrow. And actually, there's a native plant that is my favorite. It's called a sticky purple geranium. I'm actually a bit of a plant nerd. I'm in my office. I'll just kind of lean over here and show you something. So So when I went to school, I actually was a bit of a plant nerd, and we did plant pressings. I don't know. You can't really see them. I'll put them next to my face. Yeah, you can't see them. We did that native plant pressing. So I've got my offices full of local native plants from southern Alberta. So I am a bit of a plant nerd. So those are my two, sticky purple geraniums and lupins.
Awesome. Ben, we've lost a little bit of your sound. If you could just readjust your headphones there so we could hear you
a bit better. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, that's better. That's awesome. I've got yarrow in my yard, which I really like as a perennial. And I'm not sure if it's a good water-wise one or not, but it is one of my favorites. And I do tend to underwater. So it comes back year after year, though.
That's usually a good sign. That's usually a good sign.
Okay, so I've got another question that has come in. So the question is, what happens if the Springbank Reservoir floods? So it's my understanding, Ben, that the Springbank Reservoir has been approved, but it hasn't been built yet. So if you had any information maybe on the timelines and then to let us know what might happen in a massive flood event if it were to flood as well.
Sure. I'm not an engineer, I will admit. Our engineering group is just down the hallway here, and they talk about that all day, every day. It's a super important piece of the puzzle to flood protection in Calgary. And we really have kind of a three-tiered level of flood protection. So the first one is kind of property level, lot level protections. The second one are those flood barriers that I mentioned that kind of go through downtown. And the last one is upstream reservoirs. And they're an important piece that kind of help connect, you know, the three legs to the stool, if you will. I don't know specifically the timelines. We're kind of waiting to hear from the province kind of what the next big steps are. But my understanding is what happens in a really big flood, kind of like 2013, is floodwaters are diverted to what would be the Springbank Reservoir and help fill that up, diverting them off of the Bow River, where it would have just come through Calgary. And then as the floods were reside, they start to release the water back out of Springbank Reservoir into the Bow River. So really acts a lot like our Glenmore Reservoir, how they'll keep water when there's too much of it and release it slowly as we don't have as much water.
And I've also heard that the Springbank Reservoir will play a dual purpose, but it may help us to hold back some water to help deal with drought situations as well. Is that correct?
I hope so. That would be fantastic. Yeah, that's my understanding as well.
Okay, awesome. Well, I don't see any more questions coming in here, Ben, but I did want to ask you just personally, what have you done around your own home to make your home more water efficient?
Awesome. Yeah. Like I said, I'm a bit of a plant nerd and I love it. We have done, like I said, we used Yard Smart for our backyard and our front yard. We planted all native plants and I would say it looks like a mountain meadow. I love it. I use not much water at all. We still have a front lawn, a green lawn in the front, but I make a point not to water it. If it goes brown in the middle of summer, then it goes brown in the middle of summer. I definitely make as much of an effort as I can to really try to be wise about how I use my water. We have rain barrels at home. They are almost full after the last rainstorm we had a couple weeks ago, so they work really well. And then personally, the other thing I try to do is I try not to drive as much as I can. I take transit into work. Today was a great day. I actually biked in today. Why wouldn't you on a sunny Friday afternoon? Just to try to reduce my emissions as much as I can personally. So.
Awesome. So you're doing stuff on both the mitigation and the adaptation side in your own life.
Yeah, and I think everybody should try, right? Should try to, you know, try to take transit, try to bike as much as you can. And if you have to drive, don't drive a single person in a car, right? If you can carpool, if you're driving to school for, I think we have a grade 12 class in here. Mm-hmm. They're probably driving now. So if you're driving to school, pick up some friends on your way to school. I remember when I was in school, it was so hard to find parking around the school because everybody drove in and everybody took a single car. So do yourself a favor. Pick up friends on your way into school. Share the load. Maybe one person drives on Monday, one person Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, that kind of thing. So, yeah, and then I think everybody should try to do their best to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions, but also do what they can to kind of be water-wise, especially here in Calgary. Do what you can to be adapted to to what we'll be seeing for a future of climate.
Yeah, and we've got so many great resources at the city. So again, everyone will get an email from me with the resources that you've provided, Ben, after the presentation. But it doesn't look like we have any more questions coming into our chat. So I'll just let folks know that my team, the Climate and Environment Group, will be doing another presentation later today at 11 if you're interested in joining us. And we're going to talk more broadly about what's happening at the city, not just specific to water, and talk a little bit more in detail about those climate hazards and impacts as well. So thanks, Ben. That was a really great presentation.
Thanks. Yeah, that'll be a great kind of follow up to this. We kind of take a step back and look at climate change more broadly across the city. I think I've taken a look at what it is you guys have kind of got a presentation for. So definitely check that one out if you've got some time.
Super. And the last thing I'll mention then before we sign off is that a recording of this session is available for 30 days with the link that folks used to join the session. And in addition to that, we'll be posting the video on calgary.ca/MEE for Mayor's Environment Expo up until next year's expo. Awesome. So thanks so much, Ben. I guess we're going to sign off now if you want to say goodbye.
Sounds good. Thanks. Thanks again, everyone, for your interest and taking action in climate change, being part of the Mayor's Environmental Expo. It's fantastic to kind of see the action that our youth are taking, and I can't wait to see kind of the things that we do next. So again, much appreciated. Thanks for attending and have a good weekend. Bye.